Aren't you glad we can stand on the promises of God?
Amen.
Amen. Standing on the promises of God. Praise God. The young people can go to Children's Church this morning. Once again, we're glad that you are here. Turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter number 3. 1 Samuel chapter number 3. We're going to read those first 10 verses there. I'll try not to cough and sputter too much. Trust the Lord to help us this morning. Do you know God wants our attention? God wants our attention. If you ever try to get someone's attention, you'll go through extremes to get it, won't you? Sometimes our voice, sometimes our body language. There are times we'll do whatever we can do to get someone's attention. And God wanted the attention of Samuel. The Bible says, "And the child Samuel ministered unto the Lord before Eli. And the word of the Lord was precious in those days. There was no open vision. And it came to pass at that time, when Eli was laid down in his place, and his eyes began to wax dim, that he could not see, and ere that lamp of God went out in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was, and Samuel was laid down to sleep, that the Lord called Samuel, and he answered, 'Here am I.' And he ran unto Eli, and he said, 'Here am I, for thou callest me.' And he said, 'I called not. Lie down again.' And he went and lay down, and the Lord called yet again, 'Samuel.' And Samuel rose and went to Eli, and said, 'Here am I, for thou didst call me.' And he answered, 'I called not, my son. Lie down again.' Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, neither was the word of the Lord yet revealed unto him. And the Lord called Samuel again the third time. And he arose and went to Eli and said, 'Here am I, for thou didst call me.' And Eli perceived that the Lord had called the child. Therefore Eli said unto Samuel, 'Go lie down. And it shall be, if he call thee, that thou shalt say, Speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth.' So Samuel went and lay down in his place. And the Lord came and stood and called as at other times, 'Samuel, Samuel.' Then Samuel answered, 'Speak, for thy servant heareth.'" One thing I think we can all agree with this morning, if we were to turn throughout all 66 books of the Bible, you'll find that one thing is consistent, Sister Dietrich, that God is reaching out for man.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to have the attention of man. God wants your attention because he loves you. He wants to be number one in each of our lives. And it's interesting that in these books that we're reading here in the Old Testament, we're reading about judges, Brother Terry. And we read about two that are very similar, Brother Lloyd. And that is, we read of Samuel and we read of Samson. What we do know of them, Sister Tina, is they're parallel together, that we're introduced to both of them while they are yet in their mother's womb. We know about them. And they were both born to godly but yet somewhat elderly parents. They were both divinely selected and chosen of God. God wanted the attention of both of these men, and he wanted the obedience of both of these men. However, we find that their responses were not the same, Sister Tiffany. We find that Samson, his response was completely different than that of Samuel. And we find that Samuel, his life becomes what God wants it to be, while Samson's never becomes what God wants it to be. Samuel's life was very long and outlives and outshines that of his counterpart, Samson. Samuel's influence was great, and he learned to recognize the voice of God at a very young age. God got his attention, and he obeyed and served the Lord for many years. Listen, for whatever's ahead of us, and I pray and I hope and I believe for all of us that there are many years ahead for each of us. But one thing that is certain about those years, that God wants the attention of you in those years, and God wants your obedience in those years. Mm-hmm. We see that in this chapter, things were dark. It's a reminder to us that no matter how dark things are or how bad things are, that God never will leave us or anyone in this world without a witness. Mm-hmm. He loves us. He beckons us. He wants relationship with us. And that's what we see in the life of Samuel, that he is wanting a relationship with God. Can you imagine what it would be like? Here's this young man. Can you imagine being awoken out of your sleep? Last night, my wife was waking me. The girls were running fever. But it took me a little while, Brother Walt, till I responded to her, because I don't wake up so easy. I just don't. Sister Beverly, typically in my everyday life, I never have a problem laying my head down on the pillow and going to sleep. And when I go to sleep, that's what I'm there for, to go to sleep. And so a lot can happen, and I don't hear Brother Dennis. And even when I do get up, you know how it is, Sister Dietrich? Your eyes maybe feel a little crusty, a little tired. It's dark. There's not much light. You know, you're fumbling, you're falling, you're bumping. No, don't look at me like I have a third eye. We all know what that's like. And so here it is, Sister Tina, that this young man is being woken up. But Brother Eddie doesn't have a problem. He gets up. He doesn't fumble. He doesn't complain. He, without hesitation, he goes and he finds Eli. And he says, Eli, what do you want? God is looking for that today. He's looking for men and women. He's looking for servants who will readily get up and without fumble and without fatigue, even in the dark, listen and follow his voice. I'm telling you, God wants our attention because he loves us. And so in verse number 1, we see several things that the Bible says, and the child Samuel ministered unto the Lord before Eli, and the word of the Lord was precious. Or another way that we can describe this word precious is that it was rare in those days because there was no open vision. The Bible, when it says a child, it's the same word that is used for David when he slays Goliath. So it's not looking at an infant, it's not looking at a toddler, but it's looking at more of a teenager, someone who is young there. And so the Bible says that there he was, a child, and God spoke to him. God wants to have a relationship even with young people. It doesn't have to be when they're a daughter or they have a history of life underneath their belt. God wants a relationship with young people. I believe it was Isaac Watts, that great hymn writer. He was saved at the age of 9 years old. Jonathan Edwards, who preached that tremendous message, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, he was saved at 7. There are others who give testimony that even at 5 years of age, they come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. God wants to walk with people throughout a lifetime.
Amen.
Praise God. Talk about being faithful. God is faithful. And there was no, the word of the Lord was precious, and there was no open vision. There wasn't that of hearing the word of God. It was rare and scarce. And so not very many people were publicly talking about God. Even the priesthood, Brother Dennis, Eli wasn't doing his job. Boy, a lot different than our Eli, isn't it? Amen, our Eli. Amen. He's got it together, so we appreciate our brother Eli. And so the Bible says that every man did that which was right in his own sight. You ever listen to the news? You ever notice that everyone wants to do what's right in their own sight, and everybody has an opinion these days? There's all kinds of opinions, and everybody wants to do their own thing. You know, let me just say, there's not a need for a third bathroom. Amen. It's already been established by God. Everyone wants to do their own thing. And that's just the beginning of a line of lots of things. Amen. To show us that we are living in a similar day and hour. Amen. We need the authority of God's word. Amen. That will help us know how to live. Amen. That will drop the spirit of the Holy Ghost in our heart. Amen. And we want to grab hold of the word. And we want to do it the way that God wants us to do. Amen. God's not concerned about our opinion. They're deluded. They're mixed up. They're jaded. They're not right. Amen. There's nothing holy about our opinion within itself. We need God's word. And so here it is. There was a famine, the Bible says. It wasn't a famine of bread and of water, Brother Walt, but it was a famine of the bread of life. Amos says it this way: "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord." There's a famine in the land. God's looking for the attention of men and women that He may speak to you. See, it's much like Matthew says, the people draw nigh unto me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. They lose their first love. Let me look at some things this morning that cause us to lose our first love, that get us away from really being in the place where God gets our attention and God speaks to us. You know, when we decide that we're going to delight in someone or something else more than we delight in the Lord, we're losing our first love. I can delight in your friendship. Friendship is a wonderful thing. I believe that life should be full of friendships and relationships with people. I believe marriage is a wonderful thing. The Word of God says, "He that findeth a wife findeth a good thing." Marriage is good and it's honorable, and the bed is undefiled. The Word of God says, it's all good. But when those relationships become more intense and more of a priority than our own relationship with God, amen, we're putting ourselves in a place to experience famine and darkness. Am I negating the importance of marriage? No, not by any means. I'm saying you want to have a good marriage. Amen. Put God first. Am I negating the fact that God has not put around us friends and family and relationships? No, they're all very good. But when we love them more than we love God, our priorities are out of rhythm and sync. The Word of God says this: "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment." Amen. What causes the Word of God to be scarce in our life? What causes us to not have a revival in our life? What extinguishes our enthusiasm from God when other things take the place of God? Should be our desire to get up and get in the Word of God. Should be our desire to get up and find a place of prayer. Should be our desire to honor God above all other things. Listen, I know life can be exhausting. I know it can take our efforts and our energies, but we've got to put everything we can into our relationship with loving God. When we lose that desire in our soul for a close fellowship with God, the Bible says that Enoch walked with God. How's our walk this morning? Those are the things that cause famine and darkness and scarceness of the Word of God. How about in our life when we're not willing to give to God's work, amen, and to the needs of others cheerfully? "But whosoever hath the world's good and seeth his brother in need and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from it, how dwelleth the love of God in him?" How's our life when it comes to comparing with others? How's our giving? Have you ever met someone who really just seems to have nothing, but yet they give everything? How can they do that? Do you ever meet folks that are that way? Sister Beverly, you know what? Because I wonder if those folks are so used to having nothing that it really doesn't matter to them about things. They're willing to give, Sister Tina. The Word of God says, how dwelleth the love of God in us if we shut up our vows of compassion, if we shut up our giving to others. Oh, God, help us. Amen. When we don't treat every other person and every other Christian as the Lord would, rudeness and hatefulness, arguing and selfishness, it robs us of our spiritual enthusiasm and our zeal. God, help us to love one another as God loves us and loves others. I'm talking about a famine from the things of God. We strive more for popularity and acclaim in this world rather than the approval of God. Can I ask you, whose approval do you seek most this morning? Whose approval do you seek most? Eli's problem was he sought the approval of people. He sought the approval of the world more than he sought the approval of God. So God wasn't able to speak to him, brother. While God was seeking and wanting a relationship with mankind, he wanted to give the word. He wanted to move, but no one wanted God's moving more than anything else. So here is one young man named Samuel, amen, who God says, he is the candidate and I will speak to him. God's word, it was precious because it was rare. In Samuel's day, it was a despised book. In Josiah's day, it was a forgotten book. In Jeremiah's day, it was a neglected book. In Malachi's day, it was a rejected book. In Nero's day, it was a condemned book. And I wonder, in our day, if it isn't a mutilated book. It's so cut up and diced and watered down. God, help us to take the word of the Lord and share it with others. Verse number 2 said, it came to pass when Eli was laid down in his bed and his eyes began to wax dim that he could not see. It was the deep hours of the night. The crickets were cricketing. The frogs were chirping. Brother Walt, the windows, the curtains were closed. And there was no time soon that they were going to be open to the morning light, Sister Terry. It was dark. And God says, I see that the lamp of the Lord, Sister Tiffany, was just about to go out. It needed some olive oil. It was about to burn out, Sister Dietrich. And so the Bible says that here was Eli. His eyes were dim. It wasn't just a physical condition, but it was a spiritual condition. There was no vision and no sight for the things of God. Indifference, unmoved, unconcerned, disinterested. But all God wanted a relationship with his people. Let me ask you this. To be a good father, there's a new Christian song that says he's a good father. I like the song. But let me ask you, what are the elements of a good father? Let me tell you a little bit by my experience. You all have your story, you can share it anytime. But my experience of being a good father, Brother Walt, is this. Is that when the girls are hurt, well, I like to go over and make sure they're okay, and I like to comfort them. Sister Tina, I go off to work every week because I need to provide for them. It's provision for them. And Brother Elam, you know what it's like. You like to have good times. You like to play. And you like to see them laugh and have fun. Sometimes I'm the horsey, Brother Dennis. I'm down on the floor crawling around on my hands and knees because they want to ride the horsey. It's all about being a good dad. I like to do things to make them laugh. I like to do things to make them comfortable. I like to do things to provide for them. I love all that. But you know, Brother Dennis, there's times where I have to say, no, you are not going to do this. We do not respond this way, and we do not act this way in our house. And no, you're not allowed to go here. And no, the boundaries are off. You know what? It's not because I'm a bad dad. It's because I'm a good father. Sister Tina, I want them to know that life isn't all about doing what you want to do. And I want you to know that should you do this, there is a risk of you getting hurt. And so with all these things in mind, I want you to think about this. church and the Word of God, the message of God, Sister Jenny, it's not for me just to feel good always, but there are times, Sister Tina, I'll hear a message and it steps on my toes, or I'll read the Word of God and it steps on my toes. You know why? Because He's a good, good God, and He's trying to get my attention. He's trying to wake me up. He wants to work and move in my life. Know that when God begins to work and move, the revelation of God, amen, He wants to work in our life. He wants to speak. He wants to commune with us. And sometimes, even though the words should hurt, God wants to move in us. Yes. Some folks refer to this as Samuel's being spoken to. Samuel! And he runs to Eli. I didn't call you. Three times it happens. Finally, Eli perceives something's going on here. Sister saying something's going on. Why does He keep coming to me? It must be the Lord. When God speaks again, say, "Speak, Lord, for Your servant heareth." And He does. You know, God speaks to us, and He wants us to hear His voice. When He speaks, respond. Sometimes He uses calamity. The member of the prodigal son, the pig pen, he wakes up and smell and the sloth and disillusion by it all. He woke up. You remember the motel called The Whale? He woke Jonah up. God knows what He is doing. Whatever it takes to get our attention, God wants to speak to us. But I don't believe we have to be the big bear. I don't believe I have to be the belly of the whale. I believe that God can speak to us as we simply say, "I'm shutting the door, even though it's dark and there's a rarity of God's Word. Even though others may not think it's popular, I want to hear from God." This morning, I simply want to say this to you. God wants your attention. God wants to speak to you. Would you allow Him to do that? In the middle of the night, and even though you're tired, and even though spiritually it is dark, God is still speaking to people. This morning, can we do this? Come together and round about the altar. Say, "God, here I am. Speak for Your servant here." God wants a close relationship with you. God wants to give you a fresh word from Him. I'm glad to know that I don't have to live on yesterday's word or yesterday's manner. But God has something new for me today, Sister Tina. Every day. And you know, it could be the same scripture that I read before, but now God gives me a new understanding of it that meets me in my hour, Brother Walt. God wants to speak to us. And I know that He's a good, good God. But even if He's saying, "No, I don't want you to go here. No, I don't want you to do that. No, the boundaries are drawn." Know that He's speaking because He loves you and He's trying to get your attention. God is a good, good God. Would you say, "Speak, Lord, for Your servant here." It goes on now to say, God says, "And I want to do a greater thing in Israel, a great thing through you." I believe God wants to do a great thing in your family. I believe God wants to do a great thing in Miracle Bible Church. I believe God wants to do a great thing in Upper Dolphin because of you and your listening. Would you gather in this morning? Amen. We don't need piano playing, and we don't need anything else. All we need is a blessing of God. Word of God, and Spirit of God. Would you gather in this morning? Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen. God wants to speak to you. Amen. God wants to speak to you. Hallelujah. Speak, Lord, for Your servant here. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.